అజయ్ నమస్కారం జై హింద్ కార్యక్రమానికి స్వాగతం సుస్వాగతం ఈ రోజు ఈ ప్రత్యేక జై హింద్ కార్యక్రమానికి మీ అందరికీ ఘన స్వాగతం 72వ గణతంత్ర దినోత్సవ శుభాకాంక్షలు మీ అందరికీ ఆ సందర్భంగా ఈ రోజు మనం ఈ ప్రత్యేక కార్యక్రమాన్ని చేస్తున్నాం ఈ ప్రత్యేక కార్యక్రమంలో మనతో పాటు ముఖ్య అతిథి ఉన్నారు వారిని ఒకసారి ఆహ్వానించేసి మన కార్యక్రమాన్ని మొదలెడతాం మన జాతీయ గీతంతో జాతీయ గేయంతో సో మన ముఖ్య అతిథి ఎయిర్ వైస్ మార్షల్ విద్యాసాగర్ భారతి గారు వీరు ఎన్నో పథకాలతోటి గౌరవించబడ్డారు వీరికి యుద్ధ సేవా మెడల్ వాయు సేవా మెడల్ వాయుసేనా మెడల్ తర్వాత విశిష్ట సేవా మెడల్ అలాగే డీజీఎస్ కమెండేషన్స్ ఇలా వీరికి ఎన్నో పథకాలు వారి వారు దేశానికి సేవలు అందించిన తరంలో వారికి లభించడం జరిగిందనమాట వారి అత్యుత్పత్త సేవలకి మరి వారిని ఆహ్వానించి తర్వాత మన జాతీయ గేయం తోటి కార్యక్రమం ప్రారంభిద్దాం అ వెరీ వార్మ్ వెల్కమ్ టు యూ భారతి సార్ టు జై హింద్ ఆన్ టోరీ రేడియో
థ్యాంక్ యూ సో మచ్ థ్యాంక్ యూ థ్యాంక్ యూ
వెరీ హ్యాపీ రిపబ్లిక్ డే టు యూ సార్
అండ్ హ్యాపీ రిపబ్లిక్ డే టు ఆల్ టు యూ అండ్ టు యూనిస్టర్స్
Thank you, sir. We shall start the program with our national song, Vande Mataram. Please stay tuned with us. Thank you.
Vande Mataram, Vande Mataram, Sujalam, Sufalam, Malayaj Sheetalam. श्यामलां मातरं वन्दे मातरं शुभ्रज्योत्स्नापुलकितयामिनी पुल्लकुसुमितधुमदलशोभिनी सुहासिनी सुमधुरभाषिणी सुखदाम्बरदां मातरं वन्दे मातरं वन्दे
Yes, sir. On Jai Hind program, on every Jai Hind, we start off with our army band and our national song, Vande Mataram. So here we are. I'm in Hong Kong and the time now here is evening 5 hours, 12 minutes. And sir, aap bataiye, what's the time there, sir, now?
The time here is about 2:42.
2:42 in Hyderabad. How's Hyderabad, sir?
Hyderabad is very pleasant. It has started to get warm in the afternoons, in the mornings. And we had a good flag hoisting today. The weather was very pleasant. Awesome. And the program went up very well. And then I also watched the Republic Day parade at Delhi, which was a little subdued than the last time due to pandemic. But still, you could see the Jewish and the colors and the vibrant India and the smart parade by the armed forces. And followed by and culmination with a grand flypast by the Indian Air Force.
Very nice. Truly, it really brings up all our spirits. And wherever you are, in whichever corner of the world we are, the parade and flag hoisting brings a kind of unity within minds and souls.
That's right. Absolutely right. And every year, you know, this auspicious day reminds us of the sacrifice and the valor of our soldiers who have laid down their lives to ensure that we, all citizens of this country, have a very peaceful stay and a very safe stay and in our with our families. And it also displays the glory of the common people also and their contribution in well-being of the nation.
Yes, yes. Indeed, it is the service and sacrifice of all our men in uniform who safeguard our borders and protect us and save us. And we are truly indebted to all the services rendered by our men in uniform. Thank you so much, sir.
Most welcome. Most welcome.
Thank you. And sir, on this day, we would also like to wish our brothers and men in uniform, brothers and sisters in uniform who are serving our country, might be celebrating their birthdays, might not be celebrating their birthdays with their family, but and doing their duty. So we take this service forward from our क्या कहते हैं हमारे सामाजिक नॉर्मल सिटीजन्स. वी वुड लाइक टू सर्व आर मेन इन यूनिफॉर्म बाय विशिंग देम हैप्पी बर्थडे ऑन दिस ओकेशन. सो कैन यू प्लीज काइंडली विश देम एंड देयर फैमिलीज आल्सो दे सेलिब्रेट देयर बर्थडेज विद देयर डियर वंस अलोंग विद देम बिकॉज दे विल बी सर्विंग समवेयर एल्स ऑन देयर ड्यूटी.
एंड करेक्ट बट यू नो द सोल्जर हु इज अवे फ्रॉम द फैमिली but he is with a larger family, much more closer family,
yeah,
which is with him. And we make it in such a manner, even in, you know, desolate forward post. Let's say he is a soldier, is at 18,000 feet and he is a sentry there and it is his birthday. The rest of the people ensure that it's a memorable day for him.
Correct.
There is a sufficient amount of song and dance and, you know, the Josh is always high, and
yes,
that is the hallmark of the Indian Armed Forces.
Very true.
And we are very proud of them. And let me assure you, even the families, we need to salute them more because the sacrifice that they make,
yes,
cannot be measured. And it's because of their sacrifice that the soldier can, you know, safely and without any worries serve the nation in the difficult terrains and situations.
Yes, sir. And that is
Before we start, I would like to just say a few words. And it's a great honor for Telangana and Hyderabad that our brave officer Santosh Babu has been awarded Mahavir Chakra today. So my compliments and my great wishes to the family and my humble, you know, prayer and salute to Colonel Santosh Babu for the gallant action that he carried out in Galwan along with his troops. And today he has been awarded Mahavir Chakra, the second highest honor in battlefield.
Thank you so much, sir. Truly, they're all, that's of no words to express our gratitude for the services and sacrifice rendered by a man in uniform. And thank you for reminding us that a pride son of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana has been awarded the second highest gallantry award. Thank you so much, sir. And we truly wish their family lots of strength and happiness and take forward the legacy that he has created. Yes, sir. Birthday wishes for our brothers and sisters in uniform. If you kindly convey your wishes, then we'll play a song for them in Sanskrit.
Yeah, my sincere and heartfelt and joyous wishes to all those armed forces personnel who share this birthday along with the Republic Day. To them and their families, may they prosper and have live a very happy and healthy life. God bless.
Thank you, sir. మనం ఈ రోజు మాట్లాడుతున్నాము ముఖ్య అతిథితోటి. వారి మాటలు మీరు ఇప్పుడు దాకా విన్నారు. వారు ఎయిర్ వైస్ మార్షల్ విద్యాసాగర్ భారతి గారు. వారు హైదరాబాద్ లో ఉంటున్నారు. కానీ వారు 36 సంవత్సరాలు మన దేశానికని ఇండియన్ ఎయిర్ ఫోర్స్ తమ సేవలను అందించారు. వారితోటి మనం మాట్లాడుతున్నాం. ఇప్పుడు వారు పుట్టినరోజు శుభాకాంక్షలు తెలియజేశారు మన జవాన్లకి. మనం ప్రతి కార్యక్రమంలో పుట్టినరోజు పాట వినిపిస్తాం కదా, అదే పాట ఈ రోజు కూడా మన జవాన్లందరికీ పుట్టినరోజు శుభాకాంక్షలు తెలియజేస్తూ ఈ పాట. ఆ తర్వాత విద్యాసాగర్ సాగర్ భారతి గారు మాట్లాడతారు. అండ్ ఒక 15 నిమిషాల తర్వాత ఎవరైనా వారితో మాట్లాడాలనుకుంటే తప్పకుండా కాల్ చేసి మాట్లాడచ్చు. కాల్ చేయవలసిన నంబర్స్ నేను ఈ పాట తర్వాత చెప్తాను. ముందుగా అయితే పుట్టినరోజు శుభాకాంక్షలు.
జన్మదినమిదం ఐ ప్రియ సఖీ, शरदनोतु ते सर्वदा मुदम् शन्तनोतु ते सर्वदा मुदम् प्रार्थयामहे भवश्यतायुषि प्रार्थयामहे भवश्यतायुषि ईश्वर सदा त्वां च रक्षतु ईश्वर सदा त्वां च रक्षतु पुण्यकर्मणा कीर्तिमर्जय पुण्यकर्मणा कीर्तिमर्जय जीवनं तव भवतु सार्थकम् जीवनं तव भवतु सार्थकम् जन्मदिनमिदम् ऐतिहसके जन्मदिनमिदम् ऐतिहसके शन्तनोतु ते सर्वदा मुदम् शन्तनोतु ते सर्वदा मुदम् सर्वदा मुदम् सर्वदा मुदम्
The meaning of the song is like this. Oh dear friend, may this birthday bring auspiciousness and joy to you forever. Indeed, we all pray for your long life. May the Lord always protect you. By noble deeds, may you attain fame and may your life be fulfilled. Now, let me tell you a little bit about our sir. And after that, we shall talk to him. Okay. So, విద్యాసాగర్ గారు హైదరాబాద్ లో ఉంటున్నారు. వారు ఇప్పుడు సికింద్రాబాద్ లో ఉంటూ ఈరోజు ఇందాక చెప్పినట్టుగా వారు మన గణతంత్ర దినోత్సవ వేడుకల్ని వారు ప్రత్యక్షంగా చూశారట, పాల్గొన్నారట. వారి గురించిన చిన్న వివరాలు ఇది ఆంగ్లంలో ఉంది, ఆంగ్లంలో చెప్పేస్తాను మీకు. ఎయిర్ వైస్ మార్షల్ సాగర్ భారతి వాజ్ కమిషన్డ్ ఇన్ 1981 ఇన్ ద ఫ్లయింగ్ బ్రాంచ్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియన్ ఎయిర్ ఫోర్స్. బోర్న్ ఇన్ ఢిల్లీ, హి డిడ్ హిస్ స్కూలింగ్ ఇన్ ముంబై అండ్ లేటర్ జాయిన్డ్ National Defence Academy at Pune. Post his initial flying training at Air Force Academy in Hyderabad, he has flown across the country carrying out various peace and wartime missions. He is a highly decorated pilot with more than 5,600 hours of flying experience. An alumni of NDA, Staff College Wellington and Naval War College. He has commanded a helicopter unit and the forwardmost base of Indian Air Force in Ladakh, supporting the air effort in the most difficult terrain in Siachen and along the Indochina border. He has also commanded the largest airbase of Indian Air Force, that is Air Force Station Yelahanka at Bangalore, where he was responsible for conducting the largest aero show ever in India. In 2011, he took over as deputy commandant at Air Force Academy Hyderabad, where, as HOD flying and ground training, he was responsible to train approximately 850 cadets each year. The air officer has also served as senior air and administrative staff officer of Maintenance Command, one of the largest commands of Indian Air Force. The air officer has distinction of being appointed on diplomatic assignment as air attaché to Ukraine and Romania. Prior to retiring in October 2017, the air officer was heading the BSF Air Wing of MHA, where he inducted an entire new fleet of helicopters and made a number of new air bases operational. For his participation in IPKF in Sri Lanka and various other operations, including HDR missions, the officer has been awarded Yudh Seva Medal, Vayu Sena Medal, and Vishishta Seva Medal. His wife is a TV compare and writer, and he has one son who is married. His son and daughter-in-law both are pilots in IAF, Indian Air Force. Presently, he freelances as defense analyst on news channels and as a visiting speaker at various prestigious institutions. He is a keen golfer and an avid reader too. That's awesome. That's amazing, sir. It's an honor to have you on Jai Hind today. Thank you so much for giving us this time on such a special day. Thank you so much once again. Bharti, sir?
Yeah, thank you so much for reading such a life. It is not like that.
No, it is truly inspiring. And tell us, sir, what motivated you to join the forces? As a child, what motivated you to dream about flying?
Biblical, your listeners, you know, those days, I'm talking about late 70s, India was a different country, you know, especially for young boys and girls. We had very limited avenues to pursue, unlike and everybody would either do a medicine or engineering.
True.
So there was a race to either join that, and I was selected to do engineering. But one of my cousins from North, from Delhi, said that, why don't you pursue a career in the armed forces? There is something called National Defense Academy, and it's a competitive exam, and why don't you try for it? So I, just for the heck of it, I went for the exam, and you know, I did well, I passed. I went for service selection board, and I had given my first choice as the Air Force, because those days becoming a pilot was very, very, you know, glamorous. Not very many pilots were around in the country. So here I was given a chance, you know, and without any cost to my family, you know, to become a pilot. So that motivated me. And then I, when I joined NDA, it was, you know, the training that was imbibed onto us and made up, you know, men out of boys. It was a great, great, you know, training which molded me. And I took it up on myself to become as good a pilot as I can be and serve the country as far as possible and as much as possible. So it was, I will tell you very frankly, that I had not made up my mind, in the, like some people say, from very early days in life. It was just in my, you know, 12th standard or so when I was giving these exams and I got exposure to what, you know, I can become in NDA and post-NDA, that I got interested in becoming an Air Force pilot.
And during the training, as you said, it really changes, rather modifies a boy into a gentleman.
Absolutely.
So wasn't that hard?
It was one of the toughest training that I have gone through. Very frankly, I was from a civil background. I was studying in Bombay, and you know how Bombay is. There are hardly any, you know, focus on outdoors. And more focus on studies and a little bit of, you know, because the schools are like that, though I was in a public school. When I came to NDA, there I realized that there's a lot of focus on outdoors. And the training was very tough. We used to get up at least, if not earlier than 5 every morning. And the training used to continue something or the other, late in the evening and way into the night sometimes. And it was tough. It was very tough, but then I survived somehow and carried on with the training. But it is one of the finest institute in the country. I mean, there is no other institute in the world, I will say, where you have trained so many people together. And Army, Air Force, all the cadets get trained together. And the camaraderie that gets developed helps us later on life when we conduct our, you know, day-to-day or operations, or I will say in situation of war. This camaraderie, this joinmanship helps us a lot, and the foundation is laid in NDA.
Truly. Many we keep hearing about our veterans talking about their batch, you know, 80-89 batch, and they're all still together, though in different, as you mentioned rightly, whether it is Army, Air Force, or Navy. they're all trained together and they still have that batchmate thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah, truly. And your flying hours, you have to have certain flying hours to be given the pilot's license, isn't it, sir? So how was your first flight?
We came to from NDA after 3 years of training. Then we do 1 year of training in the Air Force Institutes. That is starting from, during our time, the first phase was in Bidar, which is border of Hyderabad, at Karnataka.
Karnataka.
That is called Elementary Flying School. And first time I was, you can imagine, you know, tell you very frankly, those days it was not very common to people to fly. So even my experience in a normal commercial aircraft was not there that much. And here I was put in the cockpit, and as a young cadet, young boy, I was, you know, trained to fly. But I would give credit to my instructors who took interest and, you know, made a pilot out of us. Initially it is thrilling, one or two sorties, but then when you get into serious business of aviation, then you realize it is a tough thing. One has to be really, very sharp. You have to work hard. You have to prepare on ground as much as you want to prepare or is possible, and so that you are ready to fly the aircraft. And military aviation is tough because they don't give you too much of time to get your flying skills, because it's a limited, you know, resources, and more people have to be trained and limited resources. So unlike military, civil, you can continue for, you know, 50, 60 hours and then you can go solo. Here you have to go solo flying in 14 hours. Just after 14 hours of training. So it's a very thrilling thing and very satisfying if you make it. And let me tell you, not very many people make it. There is a lot of rejection during a course. And and if you are young boys or girls who are listening, you have in Indian Air Force, we call something called Pilot's Aptitude Test. This test you get only once in a lifetime.
It is a,
something like a simulator test on ground before joining in or the training institute in AFA. This is done only once in a lifetime. They test your aptitude to check your psychomotor, you know, coordination and your aptitude to fly. If you can make it, then only you are, you know, taken up for training for flying in the air.
Wow. So as a air staff officer at Jammu Kashmir and Udhampur, you know, two different places and two different altitudes, we can say actually. How was it for you there, sir?
I will tell you, one of the finest, you know, most satisfying posting of mine was in north of Ladakh. Because we were, if you remember or if you know, that Siachen is a disputed area.
Yes.
And we are very comfortably placed because of the actions that we took. And before, and the normal skirmishes were going on. So it's a very, very critical area for us, strategically for India. And our troops are really guarding it under extreme conditions. And so in that area is also very difficult because of high altitude. You know, you fly, the landing drops zones or landing helipads are as high as 15,000, 16,000 feet. And so the air is very rare. So, you know, the power that the helicopter can generate is much less because of rarefied air. So turbulence is another factor. Because of continuous snow, there is something called whiteout effect, which your pilots can get into, because if the all below is white and if the clouds are there, so everything becomes white, so you are in a bubble. So disorientation takes place. So there are all sorts of factors which play on human body, on the aircraft. So in this difficult environment, one has to deliver and fly safely so that your troops whom you are transporting or people you are taking or you are supplying, they are given on time safely. So it's a very, very difficult environment to fly. One of the rarest in the world. Nobody in the world flies at that altitude as operations. I'm talking doctors. So only, you know, people like our country can, you know, our pilots of the Air Force are having the opportunity to do so. And it's most satisfying to do this sort of a job and this type of flying. The satisfaction that you get when you drop the troops or pick them up and supplying them critical requirements of food and fuel. So it's a good satisfaction. And unfortunately, you have to also sometimes pick up casualties for various reasons, because of frostbite or hypoxia, because of these people of that altitude get you. So when you save life at that altitude and bring them to a lower altitude to the hospital, do you feel that you have, you know, contributed something and your training has come to use?
True. Yeah. Must be really challenging under those harsh weather conditions.
Absolutely. And let me tell you, the area that is under dispute now, or there is a problem going on with China at the Indo-China border. I have flown that area extensively, and it is one of the most difficult terrain. And salute to our armed forces, both Army and Air Force, who are deployed there and present this harsh winter conditions and protecting our border and not giving away an inch. So I would request your listeners also to appreciate what harsh conditions and environment our people are there day and night and protecting our border.
Very true, sir. At least now, with the development of technology and a lot of infrastructure, we are now having some gadgets to carry on. But earlier, I'm sure 70s, 80s, maybe even 90s, we didn't have enough gadgets of those kinds to carry on under those harsh weather conditions too. Are our soldiers well equipped at this moment, sir?
Absolutely. I think kudos to the planning and resources, and that the Indian soldiers today are very well kitted, very well equipped, very well provided with in terms of their nutrition, and and even the environment, living environment, the protective huts, the prefabricated, completed, proper huts are there. They got very special clothing to look after themselves in this cold conditions. The technology in terms of armament and listening devices, equipment, and radars, drones, they have all contributed to the protection and war fighting element of our armed forces.
Yeah, their well-being at the borders itself gives us more power. Yeah. So I'll share the four contact numbers so that our listeners can dial in if they have any questions for us.
Please go ahead.
Yes, you can join us on this talk. You can call us. From USA, you may call upon 703-659-2199. UK, 020-3287-8674. Australia, 02-8006-8674. From Bharat, you may call upon 9666-77-8674. And from anywhere in the world, you may call us on Skype. Skype ID is tori.live1, tori.live1. మీరు ఎక్కడి నుంచి అయినా కాల్ చేయొచ్చు. యుఎస్ఏ నుంచి అయితే 703-659-2199, యూకే 020-3287-8674, ఆస్ట్రేలియా 02-8006-8674, భారత్ 9666-77-8674. అదే మీరు ఏ దేశం నుంచి అయినా సరే స్కైప్ చేయొచ్చు. స్కైప్ ఐడి tori.live1 lita. మీరు జీమెయిల్ కూడా చేయొచ్చు. యూ మే ఆల్సో జీమెయిల్ అస్ టు torylive@gmail.com. And we'll take a short break, a very short break, and we'll be back again, sir. Please stay tuned.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Who stands guard when a billion Indians dream? When India sleeps, who stays awake? In times of crisis, who holds your hand?
Yes, sir. So, who stands guard? That was a small intro to our men in uniform. When India sleeps, it's the men in uniform who keep guarding us. Thank you once again, sir.
Awesome.
You had also, I think, 2005 to 2008, you were as an air attache to Ukraine and Romania. Can you share us some of your experiences there, sir?
Yeah, it's a great honor, and you know, to be serving as a diplomat, a military diplomat, and representing your country in a foreign country, and as a representative of the armed forces, especially in these countries, the Indian Air Force has got a lot of ex-Soviet and Russian weapon platforms. So my job is basically to ensure that we get spare supplies and services, and because we have a lot of these weapon platforms like MiG class aircraft, the helicopters, the Mi-8s, Mi-17s, the Mi-25s and 35s, the radars, the missiles. So we have, and Ukraine and Romania post the breakup of Soviet Union had a lot of these military establishments which were had these equipments and they had the supplies. So my job was, one was to ensure that we get timely services and supplies of these critical spares for our aircrafts. And also as diplomatic corps, my job was to enhance the military to military relations between the two countries so that we can also provide what we are good at, that is especially our training establishments, that is NDA, Staff College, and other institutes of training, both in Air Force and the Navy and Army. So my job was to do that and ensure that our relations in terms of military to military get enhanced with both these countries. So it's a great experience and a great window as a armed force personnel to see how a diplomatic establishments operates and how we carry out operations, interaction between various armed forces of other countries. That gives you a great, your outlook becomes quite enhanced and you see the world in a different light when you meet people and other diplomats from the other countries. So it's a rare opportunity. And I'm very thankful that I got selected and went abroad for 3 years plus to serve the country.
Awesome. Congratulations and thank you once again for representing our country and keeping up the flag high there. So you have been training a lot of cadets and through your service, you must have seen generations of boys
boys and girls.
So boys and girls, now you have seen different generations coming in and training. So what do you see is the skill power of theirs? How is it advancing? How are they coping?
To start with, Jaya, I will tell you one thing.
Awesome.
The generation as they are coming on, the present generation is any day smarter than the previous generation, let me tell you that. The boys and girls of today are very smart, they are very sharp, they pick up things much earlier than the boys and girls of previous era would do. So they are very, very smart boys and girls, and they know what they want. They know and they adapt well, and they train well, and they are very, very clear. They are very sharp. So it's an opportunity, and they do very well when they come into the academies, because they are prepared, because they have got much more information before they come to the academies. Unlike our time, where the information was very limited.
Yeah.
So their exposure is much better than what used to happen before. Mm. So the boys and girls of today are that way much more, prepared for the rigors of training that they have to go through when they come to the academies.
That's true. And we have a friend online, sir. Let's take the call. Hello, welcome to Jayhind. Jayhind ki swagatam andi.
Namaskaram, Jay. Hello, sir.
Bon and sir, meeru
Sydney nunchi Rao maatladutunna.
Rao garu from Sydney. How nice, after a very long time, sir. Happy Republic Day andi. Namaskaram.
Namaskaram andi. Thank you. And actually, the gentleman you are talking to
is Air Vice Marshal Vidyasagar Bharati.
AVM Vidyasagar Bharati.
Ji.
Good afternoon, AVM. Actually, today is coincidentally it's not only India's Republic Day, but Australia Day as well. So, we are the holiday for two reasons. Anyway, the reason why I called is I was never in Air Force or any of the armed forces, but I've got a very sort of close association by way of my work. While in India, I'm 60 plus now, and half of my life was in India and half of my life has been in Australia. So in both countries, I worked, I work associated with Air Force. Like when I was in India, I was working on radars. And I've been to your Air Force installations at Amritsar, Patiala, Jodhpur, Jamnagar, Jammu, all these places. And after coming here also for some time, I worked on F-111 aircrafts of Royal Australian Air Force with mission control systems. The question I'm a civilian, but having seen there and also having worked for civilian organizations and having worked in close association with defense organizations in both countries. And you yourself have been to foreign countries and you would have seen a lot as well. Do you see any cultural difference? I mean, not from the technical point of view, but the cultural point of view within Air Force in India and outside India?
A very, very good question, sir. And it's nice to know you that you have been associated with in the Indian Air Force. Cultural difference is, I will tell you, there's a major difference between our armed forces and other forces in terms of, our armed forces are much more, because it's a voluntary service, first and foremost. Most of the, especially I'm talking about army, we have this regiment system where people come from a certain region and areas, and they've got very strong bonding in that regiment, which allows them to not only get look after each other in terms of as a soldier, but also during the war, it becomes a great source of inspiration and I'll say element of how to fight a war, because the prestige of their regiment comes first and foremost, this sort of environment I have not seen abroad, which and the history of various other forces is available. And if you notice, and you must have read, that the Indian troops did wonderfully well, despite not being that well trained in First World War and the Second World War and the operations that India fought with its neighbors. So it is because of this cultural background that they carry, which is much more stronger and binding, which helps them in, you know, performing in the operations that they have done so far.
Yeah, I agree with you. In fact, we tend to see the similar behavior even in civil organizations also. We, the Indians, take pride in what we do, basically, compared to Westerners. They're like, they would say, I'm at work from 9 to 5 and outside that it's my personal life. So they don't really treat, you know, how we say in India, work is worship type thing. That would not be there. So that way, I do agree that whether it's in defense forces or civil, our guys work in more dedicated and take pride in what they achieve. Anyway, it's nice talking to you. I thought today being the special day and Jayagaru doing the program, I would just dial in and participate in this.
Thank you so much, Rao Garu.
Thanks, and untan andi.
Thanks so much, Andy. Namaskaram. Thank you. Bye. That was Rao Garu from Sydney, and yes, it was good to know about the different cultures amongst the cadets and the forces of different countries. It's truly a regiment becomes a family, isn't it?
Absolutely right. Absolutely. And that is what, you know, takes them, and it's a lifelong association. It's not that they stay only there bound with the regiment. It's a lifelong association which carries on, and it carries on from generation to generation.
Yeah, that's true. Many of friends were on Jai Hind, brothers and sisters were on Jai Hind, who shared the same feeling that the regiment was there for them, you know, in times when the soldier was not home, then the regiment was taking care of the family. That's amazing bonding. Well, sir, for our youth who are aspiring to become soldiers, who want to, you know, embrace the uniform, whether in Air Force, Army, Navy, your guidance and suggestions for them. So what would you suggest? How should they plan and reach their dream?
As I told you, today's youth are much more informed and knowledgeable. But few things that I would like them to, you know, keep in mind. One is that they should keep themselves physically fit. Problem with today's younger generation is, and it is not their fault, but they are more into indoor activities than outdoor. So they need to get out and play games and do some outdoor activities so that their body is, you know, is ready to sustain the rigors of training if they come to any of the academies. So very important that they pursue outdoor activities little much more than that they do. Okay, they can pick up any games or sports or even a jog or a run. All these things will help them to keep their body fit to, you know, take on the rigors of the training. Secondly, that I would request them to do is to keep themselves abreast with the, you know, what is happening around in the country and abroad. So, situational awareness in terms of knowing what is happening is very, very important because that will be tested during their entrance exams. And also, when they come into the armed forces, it is a very helpful thing. So they need to, you know, do some reading, which is very, very important.
And generally light reading, you know, newspaper, magazines, books, other than their, you know, professional studies. They should, you know, look into these aspects. And lastly, they should also have some hobby, because during the stress of training or thereafter, this hobby will, you know, make them take on this training little more easily. Not having hobby sometimes becomes a little difficult, but it's, if they have a hobby, it's a good thing to have and to carry on later on in life. So these two, three things, and not to take life too seriously, just carry on with your normal studies, and it's not very difficult.
That's true. Keeping abreast of situations around, basically the GK, VCNA general knowledge awareness has to be there, and not that every time Google will be there with them for the aptitude test and all. They have to be abreast of all situations. And you are also an avid reader and golf player. That was your hobby. Are you still continuing with your hobby, sir, the golf?
Yes, yes. Both the things I pursue very religiously. I play golf and read. So that keeps me going, because post-retirement, that is one of the things that I've got time to do now.
That was very kind of you, sir, to give us time and talk to us and our friends from across. And it's been a pleasure and an honor to have you on Jai Hind today. Thank you so much. And we would like to continue our relationship with you and have you some other time once again. This was a very brief intro. We'll keep up the rapport.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Let's now sing our national anthem, sir. Please stay with us.
Okay.
Thank you.
अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंधु गुजरात मराठा द्रविड़ उत्कल गंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उत्सल जलधि तरंगा तब शुभ नामे जागे तब शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तब जय गाथा जन गण मंगल गायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, and have a lovely day, and see you soon again, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, dear. Happy Republic Day to you and all your listeners.
Thank you, sir. Happy Republic Day. Jai Hind.
Jai
Hind. Iroju naru Air Vice Marshal Vidya Sagar Bharti garu viru 36 samvatsaralu patu Indian Air Force lo tama sevalu andajesaru. మరి ఈరోజు ఈ కార్యక్రమం వింటున్న ఆత్మీయులందరికీ కూడా హృదయపూర్వక ధన్యవాదాలు. అలాగే కాల్ చేసిన మన రావు గారికి సిడ్నీ నుంచి వారికి కూడా హృదయపూర్వక ధన్యవాదాలు. మరి సాంకేతికంగా ఈరోజు సహకారం అందించిన సంతోష్ కూడా హృదయపూర్వక ధన్యవాదాలు తెలియచేస్తూ నేను సైన్ ఆఫ్ చేస్తున్నాను చక్కని పాటతోటి. ఈ పాట మా హాంకాంగ్ నుంచి సంగీత అనేవారు పాడారు, ఏ మేరే వతన్కే లోగో. ఈ పాట విని ఆనందిస్తూ ఉండండి. అలాగే మీ అందరూ కూడా జాగ్రత్తగా ఉంటూ దేశానికి మన సైనికులు ఏ విధంగా అయితే సేవ చేస్తున్నారు, అలాగే వారిని అభిమానించడం, వారిని గౌరవించడం, వారి కుటుంబాన్ని అభిమానించడం, గౌరవించడం కూడా మన బాధ్యత.